I think it's fair, right? Yeah. Oh, no, no.
Swastik Kopparty.
Yep.
So
okay.
It's about finding roots.
Okay, good. That's what we were waiting for. Okay, so now. okay, good. So I'm going to talk about the complexity of computing roots and residuosity in finite fields. So I'll quickly recap what finite fields are and what the exact problems that I'm dealing with. And finally, I'll also talk about the notion of complexity I'm using. Okay, great. So, okay, so the finite fields that we'll be working with are the finite fields F 2 to the n. Okay, so this is the field on 2 to the n elements. So it has cardinality 2 to the n, and if you, I mean, the usual way that one sees these things is you represent it as the polynomials over F 2 modded out by some irreducible polynomial of degree n. So that's one way of thinking about them, but okay. And the questions that we want to look at are the complexity of finding roots and residuosity. So the root problem is the following. So you're given x in F2 to the n, find x to the 1/3. Okay. So I want to find cube root or similar, so this was the cube root problem. Similarly, there can be a qth root problem. Okay, and the question is, how do you find the cube root of a number given the number itself? Okay, that's the problem of finding roots. That's a good one. So I'll say a little bit more, which talks about. I'll say a little bit more about the setting, and I'll always be dealing in the setting where the root always exists.
If it's odd, doesn't it always exist in this field, or?
That's correct. So if n is odd, you meant?
If you're like cube root 3 is odd, so cube roots will exist.
No. So that's not quite right. Okay. So, but I'll say that because a lot of people ask me. To remind them of everything before we get to business. Okay, so that's the question of roots, and the second one is the question of residuosity. So the three residuosity problem is given x, does there exist y such that y cube equals x? Okay, so is it a cubic residue? Okay, and so this will be interesting if not every element of F2 to the n is a cube. Okay, great. So just to recap the very basics that will enable these problems. So the multiplicative group of F2 to the n, so this has cardinality 2 to the n minus 1, and it's also a cyclic group. So it's really isomorphic to the integers mod 2 to the n minus 1. And so if 3 divides 2 to the n minus 1, then the operation of cubing will map all of F2 to the n star to a subset of size 1/3 of F2 to the n star. So this implies that exactly 1/3 of the elements in F2 to the n star are cubes. And in that case, there are 3 cube roots for every number. And if 3 does not divide 2 to the n minus 1, then that implies that raising to the power 3 is an automorphism of the group of of the group F2 to the n star. Okay, and therefore every element is a cube. Okay, so implies every element is a cube. n.
And it also gives you an algorithm for finding cube roots, right?
Right, and it also gives a nice algorithm for finding cube roots, and I'll go over that also in a second. Great, so okay, so this is the basic. So you, perhaps you're more familiar with quadratic residues and working in the field FP. So this, the situation there is quite similar. So if you're working in the field FP, then well, p minus 1 is always divisible, and p is odd. Then p minus 1 is always even, and you're always in this setting. And so exactly half the elements of FP star are quadratic residues. Okay, so there. So by quadratic residue, I mean perfect square. So I hope everyone's on the same page here. Okay, and the questions that so now in light of this, I will be interested in the three residuosity problem only in fields where 3 divides 2 to the n minus 1, and I'll be interested in the 3 root problem only in fields where 3 does not divide 2 to the n minus 1, just to guarantee that every element has a cube root, and here not every element has a cube root, so that the decision problem of does the element x have a cube root, so that it's an interesting question. Okay. Okay, and so finally, so all these problems are in polynomial time. So the complexity that I'll be dealing with will be in the following model of computation. So we all know it as AC0 parity, but to make it more natural in this setting, I also want to call it arithmetic circuits over F2. Uh-huh. Ah, that's a good one. So I won't talk about that problem. So, finding a root if it exists. Oh yes, all problems related to finding roots in finite fields are in P. Oh wait.
No, if it exists, deciding whether it exists, and if it exists, finding it in the not in the case where all elements are residues.
So not every element has a cube root. And the question is, if it has a cube root, find the cube root. So yes, that's also in P. Everything is in everything like this is in P, especially on the so in the fields F2 to the n, every such problem is in P. In the fields FP, finding square roots and things like this, these are not known to be in P, but they're in RP or even ZPP. So okay, great. So yeah, okay. So that should clarify. So all the problems that I'm dealing with are very well in P. Well inside P, yeah, that's.
Is factoring polynomials over these
fields in P? Factoring polynomials over F2 to the n is in P. Factoring polynomials over FP is in RP.
Yeah.
And so factoring polynomials is a generalization of the problem of finding roots, because I mean, the cube root is just a root. I mean, if you can factor y cube minus, given an x, if you can factor the polynomial y cube minus x, that will find you a cube root.
But you want to stay within the field. You don't want to go to an extension.
Right. So, but if you factor,
you could go to
an extension too, and even that is in P. Yeah.
But if you go to an extension and you factor the polynomial, then some of the roots, if there's a root over the field, it'll still be a root over the extension.
So factoring over extensions even more powerful.
Field,
yeah.
But the factoring problems are different, right? If I force you to find a factor that says that all the factors are within the polynomial over a field, or if you permit me all linear factors over an extension, then the problems are a little different.
But certainly finding all roots is a subcase of both these problems.
Right.
And so okay, great. And so the model of computation that I'm looking at is AC0 parity, or also constant depth arithmetic circuits over F2. Okay, and so let me quickly remind you what these models of computation are. Okay, so so these are circuits, and they're going to have constant depth d, and they will have n input variables. Uh, that so these n input variables are going to represent f an element of f2 to the n, at least for the problems that I'm looking at. So, and I'll discuss this issue of representation of f2 to the n in terms of bits in a second. And right, and it would be a very natural choice of representation, and yeah, it shouldn't be controversial at all. Anyway, so well, that's usually where I mean all number theoretic lower bounds for number theoretic problems start becoming controversial, because oh, you had to represent numbers in a certain way. But here it will be absolutely no, there'll be no question. Shouldn't be no question. Yeah. Yes. Right. Good. So I have input variables over F2 representing an element of F2 to the n, and I'm allowed the operations plus, which is an F2 operation, and I'm allowed the operations times, which is an F2 operation again. And in AC0 parity language, that is, times are just an AND gate, and plus is just the parity gate of unbounded Fanon, and these are enough for AC0 parity. Okay, so good. So the question is, I have an arithmetic problem over F2 to the n. I want to know if I can do it with arithmetic circuits over F2, okay, in constant depth. Okay, so this is the setting for the problem. Okay, good. And so this was the model of computation. And finally, the representations. Okay, so good. So represent F2 to the n in any linear basis. So let's see. So F2 to the n is an n-dimensional vector space over F2. Pick any basis. I mean, so this you do beforehand. This is not part of the solution. Pick any basis. Represent elements in that basis. Good. So one particular choice of basis could be, you know, write F2 to the n like this and represent it in the basis 1 x, x squared up to x to the n minus 1. But absolutely equivalent to that is representing it in any linear basis whatsoever. And the reason for that is arithmetic circuits over F2 can shift basis from one to the other. Constant depth arithmetic circuits over F2 can shift from one basis to the other at almost no cost. Okay, so if I show you that the complexity of these problems is high in one basis, then it's high in every basis. And okay, so that makes the choice of representation quite invariant under a lot of things. So I hope that that should be the natural model for computation over AC0. Computation for problems over F2 to the n, this is the right model to work with. Okay, great. So are we clear on what exactly the problem is? I'm going to present an element to you. Okay, so I know we're going to be working with the problem 3 root or 3 residuosity. Pick any linear basis for F2 to the n beforehand. Then I'll present an element to you in that basis, an element of F2 to the n in that basis. You want a constant depth arithmetic circuit that outputs, well, if it was finding the cube root, there would be n output bits, which would be a represent, there would be n output bits because the output is an element of F2 to the n. Or if I was answering the residuosity problem, then there would be just one output bit, which was deciding whether it is a cube or not. Okay? Okay, good. So this is the setting, and good. So now I'll just state the theorems that I'll prove for the rest of the talk. Okay, so sort of theorem one. So the problem of so before I get into that, maybe. Let's see, is there anything?
Two cases, I mean, it's just the parity of n that determines which case.
That's correct. So that's a good one. So if n is even, then we're in this case. N is odd, we're in that case. So that's n even, n odd. Right. So this is not a very deep condition. Okay, so are there any questions about the model, what we're trying to do? Oh, yeah?
You require the computation to be only of the function, not of the...
Of the polynomial or anything? Polynomial. Yes, that's right. It's only of the function. Okay, great. So, good. So maybe before I get to the theorem, I'll also mention two easy ways of thinking about computing cube roots and computing cubic residuosity. So as Russell mentioned, when 3 does not divide 2 to the n minus 1, finding the cube root is a very easy operation, at least for us polynomial time people, which is, it's just a powering operation. So if you, in f 2 to the n, well, we know that x to the 2 to the n equals x. Okay, for every x in f 2 to the n, x to the 2 to the n equals x. This is the fundamental identity. Based on this identity, we get all kinds of other little tricks, like finding ways of finding cube roots. So this tells you, for instance, so let's just practice a bit. So x to the 2 to the n minus 2 is the same as x inverse. Okay. Okay, great. So, in fact, so how would you compute x to the 2 to the n minus 2 in a constant depth arithmetic circuit? Well, okay, so what would I try? Well, okay, so before a constant depth arithmetic circuit, how do you compute it in polynomial time? Well, you write x to the 2 to the n minus 2 as, this is the repeated squaring algorithm, as summation bi 2 to the I. You write it out in binary. You repeatedly square x to get all these exponents and then multiply them out. Okay, good. Okay, right. So in a similar fashion, you can write a formula for the cube root of a number in this setting. So x to the 1/3. So if n is odd, then x to the 1/3 is x to the 2 times 2 to the n minus 1. Okay, so let me tell you, is that right? No, sorry. Over 3. Okay, so let me tell you why. Now, if I'm claiming the cube root, then it's easy to check it. Well, let's cube this. Well, if I take the cube of this, I'll get x to the 2 times 2 to the n minus 1. X to the 2 times 2 to the n minus 1, well, x to the 2 to the n is just x. So that is x to the 2 minus 1, which is x to the 1. So the cube of this number is x. Okay, and therefore, finding cube root is just an exponentiation operation. Okay, and good. So if I'm going to try to say that, it's hard for arithmetic circuits over F2, then I'm also saying in particular that even powering to a fixed particular exponent is hard over.
Yeah, I mean, it's not immediately obvious that multiplication over F2 to the n exactly how much
the complexity.
Right, but I mean, you got to do the convolution,
whatever. Right. Right. Okay. Oh, good. Okay. So probably I should have said this long ago. So addition over F2 to the n is definitely you can definitely do it with very small size arithmetic circuits, because addition is just bitwise addition over F2 to the n. Multiplication is also quite easily, it's easy to see that multiplication is also inside this. And the reason is the following. I mean, if I give you two elements x and y, then any output bit is some computation of the form x transpose my, where x and y are the vectors representing the elements of F2 to the n. And these are all just constant depth operations over F2. Okay, so those were the crucial observations. So addition is in AC zero parity. Any degree D polynomial is in depth D, you said? Oh, so you don't want to blow up the depth so much. I mean,
but any degree D is in depth
2
size n to the D.
Right, any degree D polynomial is in depth 2 size n to the D. Because it is, so this is F2 to the n addition. Similarly, F2 to the n multiplication. Right, so F2 to the n multiplication is a map that takes n bits and takes 2 n bits and outputs n bits, but each output of that n bit operation is just a degree 2 polynomial in the input bits, and so it's there. Okay, good. Oh, right, so I should definitely have said that. Yeah, why are we looking at cube root and cubic residuosity and studying the complexity? Yeah, so the basic arithmetic operations are definitely in AC0 parity. And the question is, are less basic operations in AC0 parity? And inverse is definitely a very basic operation, and this is a wide open question. I think it's very interesting. So can you compute the inverse in with the constant depth F2 arithmetic circuits?
And the point is that this repeated multiplication method, repeated squaring method, would require depth n, basically.
Yeah, it seems to require high depth. Yes, that's good. There are two parts to the repeated squaring that. Let's in fact look at the repeated squaring algorithm a bit more. So there are two parts to it. One is this is the same as product of x to the 2 to the I to the bi. Right. So there are two parts to it. First is you want to find x to the 2 to the I for various I, and the second one is to do the product. So it turns out finding x to the 2 to the I for various I is a one-step operation, because x to the 2 to the I is a linear map on F2 to the n, and computing any linear map in is easy in F2 over F2 arithmetic circuits. So finding all these x to the 2 to the I is just one shot. You can get all of them in depth 1. Okay, the real killer is to multiply them out. So to multiply two elements of F2 to the n takes circuits of size n square, in the naive algorithm. To multiply 3 takes n cube in the naive algorithm. To multiply n should take a very large size. And so I don't know how to do this any faster. I also don't know that you cannot do this any faster. So inverse again. I don't know the answer for inverse. No, unbounded finite products is easily shown to be not in AC0 parity, because it contains problems like mod 3 in it, but I don't know the answer to inverse, so therefore I don't know whether they're equivalent. Yeah.
If you just pair up elements, you get an AC, you get an AC1 circuit.
If you just pair up elements, AC1 is depth n, depth log n.
You want to multiply n numbers. And you were thinking of just multiplying them directly in constant depth, that would have required n to the n. But if you do pairwise, you would get depth log n.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, so that sounds right. Yeah. Right, so AC1 is probably the lowest I can put inverse. Okay, and so at the end of the talk, I'll also mention another question, which is more hands-on, such that an answer to that would help you answer this. But this seems like a very, very basic question.
What I said before about degree D polynomials, I meant degree D over F2 to the n. So degree D over F2 to the n, you need depth?
Log D.
Log D.
Oh, no, depth? No, so you could do everything in depth 2 if you wanted.
Multiply D elements in F2 to the n in depth 2?
Yeah.
But with large size. Is that okay? With size log D, say, or something. Or D.
Size
n to the D. So I can also increase the depth at trading it off, probably, but using that method, right? Okay, great. Okay, so maybe now. Good. And why did I go to cubing? And maybe this is also helpful to say. Okay, well. So what are your basic arithmetic operations? Well, addition, multiplication, inverse, definite, and then you start thinking about, okay, so square root would have been a good operation, but square root is square roots over f2 to the n is again a linear operation, because I mean x square is a linear operation, square root is also x to the raising to the x to the 2 to the n minus x to the 2 to the n minus 1, 2 to the n minus 1. Yeah, good. Yeah.
The point that makes this particular form of the powering problem easier than the iterative product is that the elements are sitting inside these smaller and smaller subspaces. Subgroups.
They're sitting in smaller. Oh, they're not sitting in smaller and smaller subgroups.
No, those are great.
The reason this iterated power could be easier, but is not, is that the numbers are very related. That you're feeding almost, I mean, some small variation of the same number to every element of the iterated product. Okay, good. So now I think now we're ready to state some theorems. Okay, so good. So theorem one is for any AC0 parity circuit of depth d and size at most 2 to the n to the 1 over 5d, the probability that over a random x 2 to the n that c of x equals x to the 1/3. So we're in the first n odd case. Is at most 2 to the minus n to the 1 over 5d. Yeah, good. So okay, so it says, okay, well, first of all, cube root is not in AC0 parity, and it's also very hard on average. Okay? And the second part is that so n even for any AC0 parity circuit, again same setup, two to the n to the 1/5d again. Oh, okay, good. Okay, so maybe I should say a little bit more. Okay, so C of X is the residuosity of X. Yeah. Is at most, 2/3 plus 1 over n to the 1/10. But I'll also say something more, which is the more interesting state or the more natural statement, that C of X equals the cubic residue symbol of X, which I'll tell you what it means in a second. Is at most 1/3 plus 1 over n to the 1/10. Okay, so the cubic residue symbol is the following. So it's like the quadratic residue symbol if you've seen it. So the quadratic residue symbol takes in an element of a field and it outputs 1 if it's a quadratic residue and -1 if it's not a quadratic residue. And the property that the quadratic residue symbol had is that it's a homomorphism, a multiplicative homomorphism from the multiplicative group of the field to plus minus 1. So the quadratic residue symbol of the product of x and y is the quadratic residue symbol of x times the quadratic residue symbol of y. The cubic residue symbol is something very similar. It is, so as a definition, so it's a map from f 2 to the n star to the cube roots of unity. And it's a multiplicative homomorphism, or it's a homomorphism. Yeah. Oh, right, great. So f 2 to the n star is isomorphic to z 2 to the n minus 1. So, and 3 divides that. So if you look at the remainder mod 3, when you represent f 2 to the n star as an element of z 2 to the n minus 1, the remainder mod 3 gives you a multiplicative homomorphism to, well, z 3, but that can also be translated into this. Oh, right, with a different choice of generator, you'll get, so there are basically two, there are two.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Fine, but you don't care, you just fix.
But any one is okay for me, okay? Okay, good. So this is often a much more natural thing to study.
There are two, but they're really the same.
One is the square of the other, and that is the square of, I mean, they're the squares of each other. Okay, good. And so just a fun fact to know is that one can get a formula for the cubic residue character. So chi of x equals x to the 2 to the n minus 1 over 3. Well, so this has to be interpreted correctly. So x is an element of f 2 to the n. If you raise x to the power 2 to the n minus 1 over 3, and this is an integer because 2 to the n minus 1 is divisible by 3, then you will get only one of three values. One of the cube roots of 1 sitting inside f 2 to the n, or the other cube root of 1 sitting inside f 2 to the n. Okay. So, I mean, if you interpret these two cube roots of unity as the cube roots of unity sitting inside f 2 to the n, then chi of x equals x to the 2 to the n minus 1 x to the 2 to the n minus 1 over 3 is a cubic residue character. The cube roots of 1, this is x to the 2 to the n minus 1 over 3. Did I mean what was the question? Okay, so, right. So a way of testing if an element is a cubic residue or not is to raise it to the power 2 to the n minus 1 over 3 and see if you get 1. If you get 1, then it is a perfect cube. Otherwise, you will get either this cube root of unity or that cube root of unity, and this will tell you which coset of the subset of cubes you're in. I mean, so one coset of the subset of cubes will give you this, and another coset will give you this. Is that good? Okay. So again, so the residuosity problem, at least the problem of computing the cubic residue symbol, is again a problem of exponentiation with a fixed, a problem of powering. So you have a fixed exponent, you want to raise x to that power, but this number is a complicated number, and so the repeated squaring algorithm has some troubles. Okay. Good. Okay. So both of those will actually start with a very simple, not a very simple, sorry. It will start with, both of them will come from one theorem, and that theorem will basically show not hardness on average, it won't show such very high hardness on average, it will just show very weak hardness on average, and then they can be amplified to those two results using some random self-reducibility. Okay, so I'll state now, okay, good. So I'll state something which I'll call main theorem, which is weaker than both of those, and the rest of the talk will be towards proving this. And I'll just say a few words about how, given this theorem, you'll be able to prove those two just by by tricks that we see in crypto all the time. Okay, so let alpha be either 2 times 2 to the n minus 1 over 3, or oh, good, yeah. Okay, so let alpha be either 2 times 2 to the n minus 1 over 3, or 2 to the n minus 1 over 3. So this is in the case when n is even, this is in the case when n is odd. So both of these are integers. And define lambda of x to be the function x to the alpha. So lambda is just is a function from f2 to the n to f2 to the n. Then for all AC0 parity circuits, C, depth D, size M, size at most, I guess, 2 to the n to the 1 over 4D, the probability over x in F2 to the n, that C of x equals lambda of x is at most 0.9. Okay, so this is this is just a weaker statement of both of those. Okay, and so I just want to comment now that given a statement like this, you can make you can get both those statements quite easily. Yeah.
So are you immediately going to go to polynomials?
Polynomials, you mean F2 polynomials or
yeah.
F?
You can approximate the circuit by a family of polynomials.
Yeah, that's right.
And then everything's in terms of polynomials.
Right, right. So I'm going to immediately go into polynomials. That's right.
So maybe it's even better just to state it.
State that as the main theorem?
Yeah. Or
right, but then it'll be an n tuple of polynomials. So I take that back. I don't immediately go into F2 polynomials.
Okay.
I immediately go into F2 to the n polynomials.
I see.
And so there will be a difference. Good. So Russell's saying that, are you going to use the Razborov-Smolensky method? And the answer is yes. But and Razborov-Smolensky method is just the method that takes AC0 parity circuits and analyzes them by comparing them to F2 polynomials. And so the answer is yes, we will eventually do that, but along the way there'll be some detour into F2 to the n polynomials. And the play between F2 with F2 to the n is where a lot of the action will lie. So, good. So I just want to say, okay, so this is the statement. Given the statement, let me show you quickly informally, how one can get, say, the first statement up there. Okay? So suppose you had a circuit that violated that. So there is a circuit that can compute the cube root on a noticeable fraction of the elements of F2 to the n. Okay. So suppose C prime, depth D again. Okay, yeah, computes x to the 1/3 on more than whatever that was, 2 to the minus n to the 1 over 10 D fraction of F2 to the n. Okay, so I'll produce from that a circuit that computes the cube root on 0.9 fraction of F2 to the n, and this will violate this theorem. Okay. Okay, so this is my description of the circuit C. So C does this. Okay, so pick B1 up to BT at random. So the point is, if I can, in order to compute the cube root of x, it's enough for me to compute the cube root of bx and the cube root of b and divide them, and this should give me the cube root of x. And or multiply with the inverse of the cube root of b. So I'll say it again, but okay, so I'll just, so philosophically or without putting my words into AC0 parity, if I get the cube root of bx and the cube root of b, then and dividing them, then I can get the cube root of x. And if I get something which is not the cube root of x, I can immediately detect that it's not the cube root of x. So when I hit a correct cube root of x, I immediately know, because I just cube it and I verify that it is indeed the cube root of x. Okay, so now I'll produce the AC0 parity circuit that takes care of this little division issue. So I pick B1 and up to BT at random, and I also ask for B1 to the minus 1/3 up to BT to the minus 1/3. Okay, so this is a non-uniform reduction, so I get to ask for the answers to some questions. I'll tell you what this means in a second without using words like non-uniformity. But so you pick B1 to BT at random, and let's say you know these numbers also, B1 to the minus 1/3, etc., BT to the minus 1/3. Then compute C of BIX times BI to the minus 1/3. Okay, this is your candidate cube root of x, and so let's call that ci, or say ai. And if any ai cube equals x, output ai. Okay, if I can have a circuit that implements something like this, then this will surely do the job. Okay,
you're using t to be 2 to the n.
Right, and t will be 2 to the n to the 1 over 5d.
When you pick the bi, when you say ask for b,
okay, so I'll tell you, so the right way to think about it is this. I'll just prove to you that there exists a circuit that, violates this, okay? And the circuit will have some hardwired parameters in it. The hardwired parameters are B1 up to BT and some more things, B1 to the minus 1/3 up to BT to the minus 1/3. Okay, so this is a non-uniform circuit that I get to design. I'm just the designer of a circuit. I'm all powerful. So
you want to query C1 instead of C.
Oh, C prime, right? Yeah. So does that make sense? So C prime is a circuit given to me. I'm going to do some side things and produce another circuit C. In my side things, I can come up with any numbers B1 up to BT that I choose, and compute B1 to the minus 1/3 up to BT to the minus 1/3, take all these things and sort of embed them inside my circuit C. Okay, so pick them at random might be confusing. So the real thing is, by magic, compute B1 up to BT and B1 to the minus 1/3 up to BT to the minus 1/3, certain elements of F2 to the n. I'll guarantee to you later that they exist such that something good happens. Then consider this circuit. So this circuit certainly is.
It's a non-constructive proof, right? This circuit.
Yeah. It's a non-constructive proof, right? So right. Is that fine? And then the way the proof works is that I'll prove to you now that there exists B1 up to BT such that this circuit will work.
And later it will show that if you indeed choose them at random.
Right. And the proof is that pick B1 up to BT at random, and that will work. with high probability. Right. So
because you can't tell the difference between BIX and, you know, BIX is a random element.
Right, good. So I didn't get explain the detail really, but okay, so we're taking C prime and plugging in BIX, where BI, right? And so I want to say that for most, for at least. Then you have to make T a little larger, maybe. Or so.
Yeah, but it's going to be like a log factor. It's going to be a linear factor larger.
Oh, right, good. Okay. Yeah, good. So in this case, you don't need the 0.9 at all. Right, good.
Yeah, but when you move to polynomial.
It's enough to prove a worst case lower one, but I don't know how to prove it without proving. I mean, I don't know any other way of proving this.
Because when you
worst case,
Yeah. Okay, so I didn't really get into the details, but I hope this is sort of clear. Okay, so given a circuit that because cube root is a homomorphism, a slight hardness of computation result amplifies into a very hardness of computation result. Okay, and a very similar thing holds also with residuosity. But if you notice, and this is a serious issue. In the root problem, I got very hardness. I mean, 2 to the minus n to the 1 over something is pretty hard. But in residuosity, I only get somewhat hardness, which is 1/3 plus 1 over n to the 1/10. So this is a serious issue. If one could replace this with 2 to the minus n to the something, this would be a huge, a very nice result, and lots of things would collapse.
But random circuits would suffice, right? So you can't really beat that.
No.
The correlation could be better. I mean, in principle.
So 1/3 plus, I mean, I'm just replacing the plus part.
Oh, okay.
So the difference is you can't check whether the answer is right in that case.
That's right.
And so you just have to take the majority answer.
And so
you're going to have to take this sort of weak majority.
Right. Yep, exactly. So that's exactly the issue that Russell pointed out. So when I compute a candidate cube root, I know if it's right. I will never get fooled in that. But for the residuosity or the cubic residue symbol, I mean, I don't really know what the answer is. So the operation of reducing theorem 2 to the main theorem involves taking a circuit that violates this and using majorities of some kind to come up with a circuit that computes the cubic residuosity on a larger fraction, and this operation of computing majority is not in AC0 parity, and so this is a basic obstacle. Yeah.
What do you mean by majority when it's non-Boolean valid?
Oh, so most frequent value. I meant most frequent value. Yeah. Okay. So, great. So for the rest of the talk, I want to prove just the main theorem.
The discussions we had before show that this upper bound is tight, this lower bound is tight in the sense that you can compute at least 2 to the n to the 1 over the or like.
So I think that is correct. So you can compute with 2 to the n to the 1 over d because of repeated squaring, and so you get depth d also. So.
Taking a product of n polynomials, if you group them into groups of n to the 1 over d, that's a 1 in.
Oh, right, yeah.
That's basically an n. If you group them in groups of k,
mm-hmm.
that's basically a degree k polynomial that you need to compute. And in depth 2, you can do that inside mm-hmm. n to the k. And that shrinks you by k. So if you pick k about n to the 1 in d,
mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So that's a yes answer. So this is cannot be improved, but this probably can be. I want to say. Yeah. Okay. And all right. And also before wrapping up, should I say it now? Okay. Maybe not. Okay. So good. So we'll now work towards proving the main theorem. So, and so before we get started, I'll just recap one of the nice proofs in this area, which is Smolensky's proof that majority is not an AC0 parity. So, I guess the normal way we know that majority is not an AC0 parity is, well, mod 3 is not an AC0 parity by Smolensky's proof of mod 3 not an AC0 parity. And then note that, mod 3 is reducible to majority, and therefore majority is also not an AC0 parity. But then this is Rasborov and Smolensky's proof from 1987 or 88. And then in 93, Smolensky came up with another proof of majority not an AC0 parity that gives it directly, and it also gives correlation bounds for majority. Okay, so I'll give a demonstration of that proof first. First of all, it's very nice, and it's short. And second of all, we'll try to follow the same plan when we prove the main theorem. Okay, good. So to introduce it, I'll sort of introduce some general principles. So principle one. This is what goes on behind the scenes in Smolensky's proof. So we'll see the principles in very vague form. And then we'll see instantiations of it in the Smolensky proof and then again in this proof. Okay, so principle one says that not all functions can have low complexity. Why? So I'm not defining anything here. But why? Well, there are only so many functions that have low complexity. So there are very few functions that have low complexity, so not all functions can have low complexity. Yep. Otherwise, you don't have a good notion of complexity. So I'll define a function f, a function to be versatile. So f is versatile if using f as an oracle, you can compute all other functions. Okay, so if every function can be computed in low complexity using f. You could instantiate it in many ways. Can be computed
it may not even be exactly an oracle call.
Oh, right. Good. So one could define so versatile using f. I just leave it as using f. Yeah, good. So this is a notion. It's not completeness. So I wanted to distinguish it from the formal word completeness by giving it a new word. So versatility. It's not meant to be a strict definition. Okay, good. So then principle two, you can guess it at the moment. Is that versatile functions cannot have low complexity. Because if they did, then all functions would have low complexity. Yeah. Oh, good. And so the idea behind Smolensky's proof of majority not an AC0 parity is one instance of this method. So a suitable notion of versatility will be defined, and majority will turn out to be versatile, and therefore it will not have low complexity in the suitable sense. So this is very vague, but I'll back it up with real theorems. So Okay, good. So, so at this point, we could take a break for 5 minutes if you want. Good. So, right. So, so what's coming up is so we'll very quickly see why majority is not necessary parity following this, and then we'll finally prove the main theorem, which will involve so some polynomials over F2 and some polynomials over F2 to the n, and right. Okay, so now I'll prove some lemma which I'll call majority is versatile. So this is Smolensky's lemma from his 93 paper. Okay, so the statement why it says majority is versatile, you'll have to stop and think of it. But so this is exactly the statement. It says, so for every f from F2 to the n to F2, there exists G and H, degree at most n over 2 polynomials, such that F is equal to G times majority plus H. Okay, so let's see what the statement says. So every function can be written in the form G times majority plus H. Okay, so now what did I mean by low complexity? Well, this is what I meant by low complexity. So using using majority, I have a low complexity computation of any function f, and the lowness of the complexity shows up in the degree of this polynomial of these polynomials G and H. These are GF2 polynomials, right? Degree and most n over 2 polynomials over F2. Yeah. So we have completely shifted the lands. I'm not even talking about the original problem anymore. I'm just.
So this is exactly how he showed something like that product was versatile.
Oh, that's right. So this is the same.
Zero, one,
Okay, and so. So I could, I'll give you a quick three-line proof of this also, and then we'll see why this implies that majority is not an AC zero parity. Okay, so why is this true? Okay, so the key fact turns out to be okay. So let's look at the set of I'll look at S zero, which is the set of all x where majority of x equals zero, and similarly S one. Is a set of all x where majority of x is 1. And so this is the lower half of the hypercube and the upper half of the hypercube. Okay? And the key fact turns out to be that S0 is an interpolating set for polynomials of degree n over 2. Okay, so and so what do I mean by that? I mean that
any
given any Boolean function defined on just S0, you can extend it to there is a degree n over 2 polynomial, a unique degree n over 2 polynomial that is consistent with those values.
N is 0 elsewhere? Or
no.
No. Oh, no. It, that is consistent. You can interpolate a polynomial through these and it goes on beyond that. And similarly, S1 is also an interpolating set for polynomials of degree at most n over 2. Okay, so in fact, this is a general fact. I mean, if you take the bottom three layer of the lowest three layers of the hypercube, that is an interpolating set for the for polynomials of degree 0, 1, 2. Right? So polynomials of degree 2. So the bottom n over 2 layers is an interpolating set for polynomials of degree n over 2.
Maybe it would be clearer. Equivalent
with
fear if you wrote it G times majority plus H times
1
minus majority.
Oh, exactly, right. So, oh, good. So, that was the rest of the proof. So, Okay, good. So S0 is an interpolating set for such polynomials. Similarly, S1 is an interpolating set just like this. So now the representation of F like this. So this will be more useful for my next step. So I'll leave it like this. So good. So now I'll come up with a representation of F as G times majority plus H. Okay. Well, S. So look at F restricted to S0. Okay. Well, that's some function defined on S0. So you can extend it to a polynomial of degree at most n over 2 on the rest of the hypercube. Okay. So extends. So F restricted to S0 extends to a function F0 of degree at most n over 2. Similarly, F restricted to S1 extends to F1, which is of degree at most n over 2. Okay, and so now I have a function. Okay, so at that point we're really done. So as Russell said, so F0 times 1 plus majority, 1 minus majority, I guess, plus F1 times majority is equal to F on all points. Okay, and this is the representation of F as G times majority plus H. Okay, so that's it. Good. So this was versatility. So now that majority is versatile, let us show that majority is not an AC0 parity, or it does not have small AC0 parity circuits. Okay, so I'll really just sketch this part. But so the main weapon that we'll use. So this is not at all an easy translation. So is the Razborov-Smolensky approximation of AC0 parity circuits. And this is the most important tool in this proof and in that proof. So it says that for any AC0 parity circuit of depth D, size M, and so let's say C goes from 0, 1 to the N to 0, 1 to the M. Good. And then for any parameter T, then so for all T, there is a set S in 0, 1 to the N on which C is approximated well by low degree polynomials. P1 Pm, which are polynomials such that. Okay, so this deserves a bit more space. Okay, well, one is, so for all x in S, C of x equals P1 up to Pm of x. Okay, so I mean C is an m output function. Then these m polynomials P1 up to Pm also compute C on every point of S. Okay, then the PIs are low degree, most. So I had a parameter T, so it's in terms of that. So at most T to the D, where D was the depth, if you remember. And finally, the size of S is large. So on lots of points, C is approximable by low degree polynomials. So the size of S is at most 1 minus, at least 1 minus m over 2 to the t times 2 to the n. Okay, so this is the Razborov-Smolensky approximation of an AC0 parity circuit by polynomials. Okay, and so this is, this has, I mean, yeah, it's not, I mean, it's not something one can, it's not a lemma unless you've seen it before. Okay, good. So using this and the versatility of majority, let's easily conclude that majority is not an AC0 parity. So these two I can. So m over 2 to the t. So this is the quantity t, as you increase it, raises the degree of the polynomials, and it also improves the approximation. Okay, so now, so suppose majority was an AC0 parity. With this small circuit, right? So you know what I mean. Good. Then get this set S and the polynomial P. Okay. With and we'll set T to be, I would like it to be log M, a little more than log M. Okay. So.
So technically, isn't the degree actually like T times log N to the D or log M to the D? I mean.
Maybe. Oh no, this is just doing the AND. I mean, this is.
Yeah, so for the AND. It depends a little bit on the fan of the AND.
So this is over F2. This is not over real for real polynomials. I don't think.
You're right.
Is that?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I was thinking.
So the log m comes if you try to do real polynomials. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Okay. Great. So. Good. So we'll set this parameter t to be log square m. So we get the set S and the polynomial, and now there's just a single output, and we get a polynomial p, size S at least 1 minus 1 over m to the little omega 1, I guess, right, times 2 to the n, and p. Okay, and what we know is that on S, P equals majority. Okay, and we also know that by the versatility of majority, that every F equals G times majority plus H for some G and H, where H of low degree. So this implies that on S, every function f is of the form g times p plus h, but p is a polynomial of low degree, g and h are polynomials of degree n over 2, and so that means that on S every function is of the form, I mean, right, so every function is a polynomial of degree at most
n over 2 plus
n, right, f every on S, that is every f is of degree at most, yeah, n over 2 plus the degree of p, which t to the d, so log square m to the d. So, but there are only so many polynomials of degree at most d, but there are lots of functions on S, and this gives you your contradiction. Okay, because so S was a large set, so there are lots of functions on S, but there are very few functions, but there are only certain number of functions of degree at most n over 2 plus this, and this gives you a bound on the size of S. Oh, sorry, this gives you a bound on. Oh, this is your contradiction, right? And if you do this a bit more carefully, this also shows that majority does not correlate well with AC0 parity circuit. So in other words, majority is hard on average for AC0 parity circuits. You cannot get it, an AC0 parity circuit of polynomial size cannot guess the value of majority right on more than half plus 1 over n to the 1/3 point, say. Okay, good. So we'll try to do a very similar strategy for cube root and powering in general. The same that works in parity, say.
Yeah.
Right, exactly, yeah.
So can you get half plus up to 1 over root n?
For majority?
Yes.
Oh, yes, you get half plus poly log n over root n, yeah.
It's
optimal. Without the poly log, maybe, or maybe with
the
even. Oh, I see, okay. So which is optimal, right? So it gives you the optimal answer for majority, but potentially it gives you not the optimal answer for residuosity. Okay, great. So to start off the proof of the main theorem, I'll say that so the statement is that cubic residuosity is quite versatile. Or cube root. Or we can take any one. Okay, I'll do cube root. And then we'll see why this implies the theorem. That will be easy. It will look very much like this, and then we'll try to prove it. Okay. So the statement is the following. Okay. Oh, in fact, so before going on with this, I'll define something called F2 degree. Okay. So given a function f from f2 to the n, so just remember, what are we proving? So maybe I'll read that out, remember. So we're in f2 to the n, and we're dealing with functions on f2 to the n, and what we wanted to show was that the function lambda from f2 to the n to f2 to the n that mapped x to x to the alpha, where alpha was one of those two peculiar numbers. You want to show that this function cannot be computed by AC0 parity circuits of small size. Okay, good. And so it's important to remember we're working in F2 to the n, so the n is down. So given a function f from F2 to the n to F2 to the n, I'll define the F2 degree of f. To be the following. So view f2 to the n as f2 to the n, and this f2 to the n as f2 to the n. Okay, so view it as, and once this is f2 to the n, this is really an n tuple of functions. Okay, so view it as f1, etc. up till fn, mapping f2 to the n. To F2, so this made you choose bases. So you chose a basis here. You chose a basis here. Represented as F2 to the n. View it like this. Then consider the Fi's as polynomials over F2. Okay, and look at the maximum degree that you see there. So max over I in n of the degree of Fi. As an F2 polynomial. This notion I want to call the F2 degree of the function f. Okay, so this seems a little even pedantic why I'm doing this, but okay, so the point is I start with a function f from F2 to the n to F2 to the n. I make various choices of basis. And represent this function in terms of these bases and as polynomials in this basis, and that gives me some notion of F2 degree, and this degree is invariant under all those choices. Okay, so that is why I can say this is the F2 degree of the function f. Okay, so So this is my definition, F2 degree.
It's not, is it obvious that it's, I mean, it's okay. So it'll be invariant up to small constant additions because of the, no?
Not up to anything. It is completely invariant.
The basis change is linear.
The basis changes are linear. So the F2 degrees of these polynomials don't change, and even this won't. Okay, good. So this is the notion of F2 degree. When you're dealing with F2 to the n and you're open to changing basis left and right, then F2 degree is a natural notion that stays despite all the reorganization. Okay, so I'll now say that cube root is quite versatile. So for all f, so much like majority, so I'm taking every function and I'm going to compute it easily using the cube root function now. So for all functions f from f2 to the n to f2 to the n, there exists g and h of f2 degree at most n over 2, such that, so far it will be wrong, but okay. So f equals g times lambda plus h. Okay, so such a statement, if it were true, would have been really smooth, and then things would look exactly the same. But turns out this is not quite true, so I'll change it a little bit, and that's the quite and quite versatile. So there is a vector space V of functions. Mapping. Oh wait, this is really bad. So there is a vector space V sitting inside the space of all functions from F2 to the n to F2 to the n. Vector space. Such that for all f, there exists g and h of degree at most n over 2, and a function e sitting inside v, such that f is g times lambda plus h plus e. And furthermore, the dimension of v is at most 1/4 of 2 to the n. So this and this. Okay, so is it visible? Oh. So it says that there is a small dimensional space of helper functions, such that if you also let me use these helper functions for free, then using cube root, I can compute any function.
And you can also probably say it in the other way, right? That if you look at the set of all functions, g lambda plus h, it forms an affine subspace of very high dimension.
That's right. Okay, so this is what I meant by lambda or cube. The cube root function is very is quite versatile.
You have to know this V exactly.
And I'm going to know V exactly also. Yeah. Well, I mean, sort of exactly. I mean, I can describe it, but I won't know its size exactly. And in this case, I guess V has no real structure to talk about, but it's just, yeah, it's one vector space which we understand well, and V. Yeah. Okay, great. And so now let me quickly show you why cube root is quite versatile. So F2 degree right now is a really terrible notion, right? Because I mean, true, it's invariant under everything, but in order to even get your hands on it, you need to choose all kinds of things. So the first thing we should do before we move on is to get a better grasp on what this F2 degree is. If we can characterize it a bit more intrinsically to the F2 to the n structure. Okay, so F2 degree in terms of F2 to the n degree. In terms of F2 to the n. Yeah, okay, that's okay. So given a function f from F2 to the n to F2 to the n, I'll just tell you a simple way of finding out what its F2 degree is, which doesn't require you to choose any bases. Okay, so given write f as summation ai x to the I. So f is a function from f2 to the n to f2 to the n. We can write it as a univariate polynomial over f2 to the n. So write f as summation ai x to the I going from 0 to 2 to the n minus 1. So this is a unique thing. Good. Then f2 degree of f is equal to the max over all the i's that have non-zero coefficients of the Hamming weight of I when you write it in binary. Okay, so the function, and it's actually so this is also easy to see once I tell you. Yeah. Oh, sorry. Oh, right. Sorry. So f of x equal to. Yeah. Oh, right. Sorry. So you can. It's a function. You can write it as a univariate polynomial. You can interpolate the polynomial, the unique polynomial that represents it. And now in that representation, look at all the monomials that show up. And amongst those monomials, look at the i's that show up. Look at the Hamming weight of I. Look at the largest possible such Hamming weight that you see. That is the F2 degree of F.
So I guess it's relatively, from what you said before, it's easy to see less than or equal to.
Right.
In that you said every time you raise to a power of 2, that's a linear transformation, that's degree 1.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. So I understand the less than or equal to. Why is it clear that it's greater than or
okay, so this is all you need to prove really. Okay, so just to get Russell's comment, so x to the 3 is x times x square, and x square is a linear transformation. So it's the product of two linear transformations. So x cube has Hamming weight at most x cube has F2 degree at most 2. Similarly, x to the I has Hamming weight. Sorry, x to the I has F2 degree at most the Hamming weight of I, because I can write x to the I as x to the 2 to the j products of numbers of this form, and each x to the 2 to the j is a linear transformation. Okay, so the claim was it's clear that this is at most this. Okay, the other direction is just dimension counting. So you know the dimension of the space of all polynomials of Hamming weight of F2 degree at most d. Well, we can just calculate that because and we know the number of monomials, the number of i's with Hamming weight at most d, and they're exactly the same. Okay, so that was it. So Russell proved it. but this is the fact that you need to know. So x cube is a degree 2 transformation, x to the I is a degree Hamming weight of I transformation, and sums of them behave like you expect them to. Okay, good. So oh, right. So I guess what ended up happening is I'm now proving the quite versatility of cube root, but I plan to show why this implies the result. But we have time for both, so it doesn't matter. Okay, good. So
those numbers alpha is a good
Hamming weight. Oh, good. So those numbers alpha. What are the Hamming weights of those alpha? Okay, alpha is 2 times 2 to the n minus 1 over 3. So in binary that looks like 10 10 10 something something and 0 1 maybe, or so there's a little fudge at the end, but 2 right, so alpha is 2 times 2 to the n minus 1 over 3. In binary it looks like this. It is just, I mean, so it comes from the base 2 expansion of 2 over 3. In general when you I mean, so it's going to, if you look at this,
so just think you multiply by 1, 1, and you get all 1s, right?
Yeah.
And then that's 1 less than a power of 2.
Good. So the map of taking cube root and cubic residuosity, these are both degree n over 2 polynomials, just because of this formula and that. Inverse is, that's a good one. So inverse is a much higher degree polynomial. So let's see why. So for that, I was x inverse, if you remember, was x to the 2 to the n minus 2. And 2 to the n minus 2 is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. Right. So this is a degree n minus 1 transformation. That's a good one. It's not XORing, it's adding.
Adding. It's adding with carry.
Adding with carry,
It would be easy if it was
like. Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
And this would be automatically.
Okay, so now I'll now prove the quite versatility of cube root up to a small fact, which turned out to be.
And you look at whether it's got lots of ones in the even positions or lots of ones in the odd positions, something like this.
Well, you certainly look at x to the I for every I, but then it gets, so this is integer addition, so it's going to be a bit trickier. Anyway, so let me just go ahead and do it. Okay. So what did I want to do? I wanted to say that every function f can be written as g times lambda plus h plus some small thing. Okay, so start with f and let's start writing whatever we can do. I mean, so some part of this is almost, there's almost only one way you can do it. Okay, so take f equal to, take an arbitrary function f and write it as a univariate polynomial over f2 to the n. Okay, so given that we understand f2 degree best in terms of the f2 to the n polynomial representation, that's a good place to go immediately. So take f, write it as f of x equals summation ai x to the I. Okay, I now want to write it as, well, something plus, oh, this is a degree at most n over 2 h. So let me just whatever I can take out as f2 degree at most n over 2, let me just do that. Okay, so h so set h equal to sum over all I such that Hamming weight of I is at most n over 2 of ai x to the I. This is a pretty decent, I mean, I didn't lose anything at all while doing this. So h is a polynomial of degree of f2 degree at most n over 2 by this characterization. So that's fine. And I already took out of f a whole bunch of monomials. So what is remaining is the set of I for which Hamming weight is greater than n over 2, and I want to try to write it as g times lambda plus some small dimensional thing. Okay. So what do I do with g? Well, I take as much as I can. That's a pretty decent thing to do. So set g to be sum over all I such that, well, lambda is x to the alpha, right? So we're looking at g of x times x to the alpha. I mean, if so, whatever exponents show up in g, the alpha gets added to them when alpha gets added to them. So take I such that I plus alpha. Hamming weights at most n over 2 is at most n over 2, and of a I plus alpha x to the x to the I, is that right? And also we don't want to take monomials that we already put into H. Okay, so I want to say that too. How do I say that? And Hamming weight of I plus alpha is greater than n over 2. Is that fine? So this is again almost the only definition I could give for g. Okay, so g is again a polynomial of degree at f2 degree at most n over 2. H is also a polynomial of f2 degree at most n over 2. And what's remaining? Well, that I'll make e. Okay, so e is the rest. Yeah. Why did I choose n over 2? Well, no other choice of it's the same reason. Nothing else improves it, so you might as well do n over 2. And you don't want to do significantly less than n over 2 is bad.
Yes,
you.
Why not more?
So that's also bad. Right.
Once you start getting even slightly bigger than n over 2,
the dimension of the space of
everything.
The crux was here. The dimension of the space of polynomials of degree 3 n over 4 plus something is huge, but the dimension of the space of polynomials of degree at most n over 2 is half of 2 to the n. So I mean, n over 2 is crucial for both reasons. You can add a little bit to it, so I don't see any fruit out of that. So that's a good point. So here I meant the unique unique representation as a polynomial of GF 2 to the n. Right. So when you multiply the function x to the I with the function x to the alpha, you get the function x to the I plus alpha. But I insisted when you deal with f2 degrees that you should represent it as the unique polynomial of degree at most 2 to the n minus 1. So it's mod 2 to the n minus 1 actually, because x to the 2 to the n minus 1 equals 1, except for x equal to 0, which is, there's a special case with x equal to 0, but, so I plus alpha is mod 2 to the n minus 1. Okay, so I've done everything I set out to do, except I have to, e came from the rest, and so let me tell you, I haven't yet used lambda, right, good point. So it's clear what the definition of V is. V is the set of all, is the span of the monomials x to the j, where j cannot be written as either a number of Hamming weight at most n over 2, or alpha plus a number of Hamming weight at most n over 2. Okay, so let's put that down. So So this gives us our definition of V. V is this span of x to the j, where j is not equal to Hamming weight at most n over 2, and j is also not equal to alpha plus Hamming weight at most n over 2 mod 2 to the n minus 1. Okay, and if the and the f- to finish it off, I want to say that the span of the dimension of V is at most 1/4 times 2 to the n. Okay, and that boils down to the following pretty neat look. It's counting and not just counting. So this is a fact that at least that I struggled with a lot, and but it looks like a neat fact. So let me state the fact just outright clearly and stand alone without any monomials hanging around. So let S sitting inside Z sub 2 to the n minus 1. So Z sub 2 to the n minus 1, I mean, we're working mod 2 to the n minus 1 when we do addition. So I'm now telling you a fact completely independent of everything we saw, just in the cleanest language possible. So I look at the set S sitting inside Z 2 to the n minus 1, where, and S is the set of X such that the Hamming weight of X is at most n over 2. Okay, so this is a set of size exactly half of this. Let alpha be the number 2 times 2 to the n minus 1 over 3. Then the size of S union S plus alpha. Well, if you remember, S was the set of monomials we covered with H, and S plus alpha is the set of monomials we covered with G. So the size of S union S plus alpha is at least 0.75 times 2 to the n. Okay, and so, I mean, this is integer addition. This is a really nasty thing. Why does Hamming weight interact with integer addition at all?
For random alpha, this is expectation.
For random alpha, yeah, this is the expectation. This is true for a random alpha, or I mean, with an appropriate number, maybe. Yeah. With this alpha, it's 0.87 or 0.86 something, but that took struggle. I mean, that's all I want to say.
For the inverse, so you can show.
That's a nice one. So
it's not true.
The inverse, this number 2 to the n minus 2 is just minus 1. Right. So S union S minus 1 has size only 0.5 times 2 to the n, just essentially 0.5 times 2 to the n. For which alpha is it true that S union S plus alpha has large size? Well, I know that if alpha is a sparse number in Hamming weight, that doesn't work. Just because, when you take a number of Hamming weight at most n over 2 and you add to it a sparse number, I mean.
Or a complement of a sparse number.
Right, or the complement of a sparse number. So the negative of a sparse number, like 2 to the n minus 2, that also doesn't work. So the if alpha is the difference of two sparse numbers, then this does not hold. But for every other alpha, as far as I know, it should hold, but I don't know how to show it. Yeah? Oh, no, 0.75 is not at all special. No, half minus, so this has to be 0.51.
Okay.
0.51, yeah, right. They would all be okay for the rest of the proof.
It might be easy to show 0.6.
Oh, that's a good one. So I don't, for?
For that particular alpha. By thinking of, you're taking that alpha and then you're, like, adding random bits to it and you have the carry bit.
So that's a good one. So ultimately, I ended up doing was I write alpha in binary, and then I note. I really analyze addition as an algorithm. So you have 1010 10 and then you write random bits here.
Okay, so that's actually what I'm saying.
A crucial thing gets used which shouldn't be used is that. So this is a periodic number. And so whatever, I mean, so there's some Markov chain that captures what's going on in this addition process. And then by looking at this Markov chain and something, then.
Okay.
Yeah.
That gives you the number.
That gives you the number, but I don't know how to.
To get the number exactly.
No, but I don't know how to do anything less if I'm ready to settle for less.
I see.
Yeah, I would be very happy to see the real proof of this. Or even the fastest way to proving this, I would be happy to see that too. No, but it's it's a fun fact.
So you're saying, okay, so consider that algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
The carry bit's either 0 or 1. That gives at any point that gives you, and you also have what you have to say, like how many. Keep track of how many ones you flipped and how many.
Right. So
ones
so the operation is you put in a random integer here, and then you see what you get as the sum. These are
right.
And look at the Hamming weights of these two, and these are correlated in some way, and how are they correlated? And what's the probability that both of them are at most n over 2, or? Uh-huh, right.
And then you have a 0, 1 as your next bit, and it's producing output, the bit that you've just flipped, and then the XOR of the carry bit, and then the bit you just flipped.
Yeah. Right, and that is that is this Markov chain that,
right.
Yeah.
So, and then sort of, seems like you're going to converge quickly.
It's not. It has a bias actually, but it's not 0 or 1 biased.
Right.
And somehow that's
right.
Important too.
And then your probability, each one has expectation 50%, and the probability of I see. You have to say what's the probability of 0, 0 versus.
Okay, so I think you agree it's tricky, at least. Yeah. So that's really all I wanted to say about it. I didn't.
So question. So both alphas for cube root and oingras are large Hamming weights.
Yeah.
Well, it has to be bigger than.
So do you know if any alpha of large Hamming weights is easy? What is your parity?
So half zeros, half ones. That is the difference. Oh, is it easy for AC zero parity? Oh, good one. No, I don't know any. That's a good one. So, sir, the versatility is false. That's different. The argument. I don't know any number with high Hamming weight for which raising to that power is easy. In particular, inverse. I think inverse is the heart of all problems. So, either a new proof to show it's not possible or a way of doing it, which is also new. Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right, so that's Shah's question. Can you even find one monomial of high Hamming weight for which you can do exponential raising to that power easily?
What is the inverse of cube root? I mean, it's like 0, 1, 0, 1, 0,
1. Oh, that's also a high Hamming weight number. What is it? Well, it's some cousin of it, maybe square of that. That's also hard, right? So the final theorem. Everywhere I said cube root, but the final theorem really is if you have any integer which is periodic. So and these periodic numbers always correspond to cube roots, fifth roots, fifth residuosity, things like this. So if you have any number that's periodic, then for all those problems, computing cube root or residuosity or whatever, raising to that number. That is hard for AC0 parity, and it boils down to the fact that when you add such a number to a random integer, then the correlation, the distribution of these two random numbers is something. So it boils down to a fact of this form. Okay? And I know it only for periodic numbers right now. Okay, good. So, well, I'm really running out of time. So I won't go into the why this implies the result, but it's what you think it is. It's very much like what happened for majority. And so, I mean, the only thing you want to, I mean, just to pay attention to, it's not, it doesn't cause any complication, is, so when I say g times lambda, I mean f2 to the n multiplication. So g is actually, you know, n bits, lambda is n bits, multiplication is this bilinear map, but I mean, so but that's it. Multiplication is still an f2 degree 1 operation, even though there are, you know, 2n numbers hanging around. Yeah, and so going through that, look, and the bound on the dimension of V, the fact that it's less than half times 2 to the n, I mean, it's half minus epsilon naught times 2 to the n, this is the crucial thing that gives you some bound. Okay, so, right, so the non-trivialness is that this is half minus something, which is the same thing as the union of S and S plus alpha is at least half plus something times 2 to the n. Okay, good. So I'll wrap up with maybe three open questions and finish. Okay, but I already said a lot of them, so. Yeah, that's correct. But then multiplication shouldn't blow up the dimension too much. So g times lambda, we heavily use the fact that the product of a low degree polynomial with a low degree polynomial is still a somewhat low degree polynomial.
Does it have to be a product or can be any combining function?
It can be any combining function. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, linear probably would be nice. So there's a lot of.
Low degree is fine.
Huh?
Any low degree is fine.
Low degree combining, you mean?
Low degree combining.
Oh, right. Any low degree combining is fine. Right. In fact, you can write polynomials. Right, right. Exactly. So, a versatility theorem of the form g times lambda square plus blah, blah, blah is very possible. And this is possible in the f2 to the n world, but not possible in the f2 world because lambda square was lambda in the f2 world. So this gives scope for various other variations on this. I mean, I haven't found a good clean problem for which this will help, but hundreds of variations of this for inverse don't work. So, yeah, I mean, that's not a theorem, but good. So some problems. Okay, so I guess I did mention everything. So first, the most important of all is X inverse. Is this an AC0 parity? So both yes and no answers are fantastic, but not both. Right. Right. Yeah, good. So the second one is So one thing that falls out of the hardness on average for cubic residuosity is the following sort of character sum bound. It says take the expected value over a random x in f2 to the n of the cubic character of x, and this is now a c valued. So when I say cube root of unity, I mean the c valued cube root of unity times minus 1 to the p of x, where p is from f2 to the n to f2, and degree at most n to the 0.1 as an f2 polynomial. Okay, so the correlation of the cubic residue symbol with polynomials of degree at most n to the 0.1 over f2 is at most 1 over n to the 0.1. Okay, so the question is, which is also very related to the hardness on average question that I mentioned earlier, is, so can you replace this with 1 over n to the, I mean, okay, so well, with lots of things. So 1 over 2 to the n is fantastic, or 2 to the omega n, or rather, okay, n to the epsilon, let's not do, yeah, 1 over 2 to the n to the epsilon, 1 over n to the little omega of 1, 1 over n square, 1 over n. They're all good questions. I mean, good. So can you replace it with anything better? So so if you know, so in the proof of this, what really happened was there was first a proof that this correlation is at most 0.99. And then it got amplified. And the amplification came from random self-reducibility. So this sort of is a very, So the random self-reducibility, I think the limit of that is at 1 over n to the 0.1, but just the fact that we got a good strong character sum bound out of the random self-reducibility was, I thought, was pretty neat. Good.
You can get 1 over root n.
Well, I don't think I can get to 1 over root n, because there are various losses of, I definitely can't get beyond 1 over root n. Good. So maybe 3 is when is S union S plus alpha large? Right, so.
For the same set as
one. Right, for that same set. So you remember the setting. So for which alpha? Good. So that's all I want to say. Question? Okay.
So with inverse, surprisingly, all the steps failed, right? You couldn't show the sets were large, so meant versatility was not a question. Do we know self-reducible?
Yeah, it is self-reducible. The moment you get a little bit, you'll get everything. Yeah, but we,
So I assume the same argument goes through if you're looking at seventh roots.
Absolutely right. So it was because when you take alpha to be the corresponding alpha, this happens.
Because it looks like almost the same.
Because it looks periodic. Yeah.
Yeah, but I guess so for any fixed roots, it's going to be periodic. So.
Yeah, that's correct. So for thought I said it, but
it may not be periodic in the same way, or
No. Rational expansion of one of
right.
So
is
fix
it true for any periodic alpha?
It's true, yeah. So this I know how to prove for any periodic alpha, as long as it's not the zero, all zeros or all ones. Fourth roots will not work because its expansion is periodic with zeros everywhere or something. Right.
Yeah.
Right. So. Yeah, so seventh roots, I mean, everything I said holds for every qth root for odd q. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, no.